G'day everyone. It's like being in a room full of Crocodile Dundees, I swear. Today I'm going to talk to you about the Lost Franklin expedition and we'll get straight into it. So ever since Marco Polo returned from his incredible 24-year overland journey to India, China, the area called the Far East, and returned talking about riches beyond any man's imagination, Europeans became obsessed with being able to get to that region. Now, over the period of time, the only two sea routes that became available to Europeans were to either travel all the way down the Atlantic Ocean under the bottom of South Africa at the Cape of Good Hope, and then all the way across the Indian Ocean, the route that was pioneered by Bartholomew Diaz and Vasco da Gama sailing for the Portuguese. Now, the other route was all the way down the Atlantic again, under the bottom, around Cape Horn, and then all the way across the Pacific Ocean, the route that was discovered by Ferdinand Magellan, another Portuguese, but this time sailing for the Spanish. Now, both of these routes were more than 12,000 miles long, and they were absolutely fraught with danger. And over the years, thousands of ships and tens of thousands of seamen, their passengers and their very valuable cargoes were lost to the sea forever. And it was thought there had to be a better way. And for four centuries, people became obsessed with finding a northwest passage to the north of the Canadian border, across from the Atlantic into the Pacific. Now, certainly during the winter months, as that ice marched down from the Arctic and crushed into that Canadian coastline, there was no chance that a ship could get through. But it was thought that come spring and summer, when the ice melted and retreated further north again, that they would be able to find a route to get through. And for the country that was able to find it and control it, it would be an economic bonanza. For the man who was able to discover it, it would mean immortality and fame. This man, to me, is a British naval hero. Sir John Barrow, I think he should have a statue beside Nelson in Trafalgar Square. But he never wore a uniform and he never went to sea. He was actually the second secretary of the Admiralty, the senior bureaucrat at the Admiralty for more than 40 years from 1804. He controlled what the Royal Navy did, basically. And under his watch, it became the most powerful and professional navy that the world had ever seen. He introduced a lot of new innovations to the Royal Navy. It was a case of any man, he brought in uniform training so that any man could go from one ship to any other ship in the fleet and they knew exactly what their roles and responsibilities were. He offered cash prizes for innovations in things like navigational equipment, weaponry, to upgrade the standards of the Royal Navy. He also brought in, enshrined into legislation, the notion that every promotion in the Royal Navy had to be solely based on merit and not who your family, what your family name was or what connections you might have. And he introduced what all navies take for granted these days, and that's war games, where units of the fleet would train in wartime activities against other units of the fleet to hone their skills and their tactics give them an advantage over the enemy. And during his time at the Royal Navy, the British fought battles or wars against the French on several occasions. They fought wars against the Spanish and the Dutch and the Americans. They fought wars against piracy and against slavery. And when all those wars had been fought and they'd all been won, he sent his navy out on voyages of discovery to search, to map the entire world and make discoveries all around the world. It was a wonderful career. But he was coming to the end of that great career and he wanted one more triumph and he wanted the big one. So he organised the best resourced, most scientifically advanced expedition of all time to finally find the Northwest Passage. Now he knew that he needed the right man to lead that expedition. But before he could ask the man that he wanted, he had to play some politics, stroke some egos, and he had to ask a man that he knew would turn down the offer to lead the expedition. And that man was Sir William Edward Parry. So Parry was the godfather of British Arctic exploration. He had been to the Arctic on 8 occasions, an incredible explorer, incredible career. In 1825, he set a new record for furthest north, and that record held for more than 50 years. But he was now 60 years old. At that time, that was considered old. His exploring days were over. But because of his status, he had to be the first person asked, and as expected, he politely declined the offer to lead the expedition, but honour was maintained. And that meant that Barrow could now ask the man that he really wanted to lead the expedition, and that was Sir James Clark Ross. Now, Ross was your quintessential British hero. Tall, dark, extremely charismatic. He was reputed to be the most handsome man in the British Navy. Women loved him, and his men would follow him to hell if he asked them to. But he also had a lot of experience. He'd been to the Arctic on 2 occasions with his uncle, Sir John Ross, and on one of those occasions, young James became the first man to reach the magnetic North Pole, which is a different location to the geographical North Pole, which of course is where Santa lives. He went to the magnetic North Pole, and he'd also been to the Arctic twice with Parry, the last time as Parry's second in command. So a lot of experience there. But even more important than that, he had just returned from leading an expedition of his own to the other end of the world, to the Antarctic. To give justice to this expedition, I'd need another half an hour to talk about it. It was an incredible expedition. They discovered dozens of new forms of marine life, birds, plants, etc. They did a lot of experiments in navigational equipment and other scientific experiments. His two ships that he took there, down there, HMS Erebus and HMS Terror, set a record for going furthest south at that time. In fact, those two ships still hold the record of furthest south for a ship that doesn't have a motor on board. So just incredible. Mount Erebus, which is the southernmost active volcano in the world, is named after one of the ships. Nearby Mount Terror is named after the other ship. The Ross Sea, which is just south of New Zealand, Ross Island, and the incredible Ross Ice Shelf, which is about the size of France in Antarctica, are all named after Sir James Clark Ross. In fact, there's more surface area of the Earth named for him than any other person. So he was the perfect person to lead this expedition. But there was a problem. When he had returned from Antarctica, he had married a stunningly beautiful young woman, almost half his age, and he promised his new bride that at the age of 44, his exploring days were over and that he would stay home with her and start a family. So when he was offered the opportunity to lead this very prestigious expedition, he had a choice to make. He could either break his word to his new bride, which, gentlemen, we all know is not the smartest thing in the world to do, don't we? And he could go off for 2, 3, 4 years, who knows, with a bunch of smelly men living on a cramped, dark ship, cold ship, eating awful food, or which is something he'd already done several times before, or he could stay at home with his beautiful wife and they could start a family and they could continue to be the darlings of London society that they were. And unfortunately for Barrow, he chose option B, and he also declined the offer to lead the expedition. But he recommended the man that he thought would be the best man to lead it, and that was his best friend, the man that had been best man at his wedding, and the man that had been second in charge on that incredible voyage to the Antarctic, and that was a man by the name of Francis Crozier. But once again, there was a problem, or there was a few problems on this occasion. The main one was that Crozier was Irish. There was no way the English were going to allow anyone other than an Englishman to discover the Northwest Passage, let alone an Irishman. It was also even worse than that, he was bog Irish. He'd risen up through the ranks. He wasn't a gentleman. There was dirt under his fingernails, so he wasn't suitable. And the other problem also was Crozier himself. He didn't like the publicity and the pressure of being the person in charge. He would prefer to be the man behind the scenes, making sure that everything got done properly. He was a perfect second in command. So he was offered and he accepted the role of second in charge on this expedition. So Barrow threw the net out even wider, and after a lot of pressure that was brought to bear on him, eventually Sir John Franklin was named leader of the expedition. And this was a strange choice because Franklin was 59 years old himself. He hadn't been in good health. He hadn't had a command at sea for more than 25 years. But he was a very popular man, very highly regarded by people, and it was a popular decision to appoint him. He'd been born in Lincolnshire in 1786. He was the ninth of 12 children. Not sure whether his parents really wanted their own cricket team but 12 children's a good effort, isn't it? You've got to applaud that. At the age of 14, he joined the Royal Navy, and as a midshipman, he fought in one of Nelson's great victories, the Battle of Copenhagen, before transferring out to the Australian station, where he was involved in the very first close circumnavigation of Australia under the command of Matthew Flinders. And then he was sent back to Europe again, and in 1805, he was involved. He fought well and distinguished himself at the Battle of Trafalgar, another of Nelson's great victories. And we'd be passing by that region in a couple of days' time. And then in 1819, he was given command of the copper mine expedition. Now, for some reason, you decided that you wanted to investigate or research a very poorly led expedition. This would be the one that you would pick. It was a dog's breakfast. It was... once again, to give it justice, I'd need another half hour. But the plan was that Franklin and three other Royal Navy personnel were going to go to Yellowknife and recruit frontiersmen to take them to the northern coastline of Canada to map that coastline, once again looking for the Northwest Passage. But when he got to Yellowknife, he couldn't recruit any experienced people because they were all French. And the French had no liking for the Royal Navy because they'd been at war with each other several times. And they, especially when they found out where they were going, which was uncharted territory, and that they were going to be paid the normal rate of the Royal Navy, and they could make a lot more money from trading beavers. But he was able to recruit a group of 20 men, they were 20 in total, but these were people that either had no experience in the wilderness or had tried in the wilderness and had failed, but just needed some sort of income. They set off. Things went bad from the very, very start. They got way, way behind schedule. They spent a disastrous winter. Even though the forests were full of game and these streams and rivers were teeming with fish, they couldn't seem to catch any of them at all. And soon the men were absolutely starving. They eventually got to the northern coastline of Canada, and Franklin insisted that they keep going on. Now, you have to remember that he was a lieutenant in the Royal Navy. And there was hundreds of lieutenants all waiting for the next promotion. If he had just quit and gone back and said it was too hard, he would have gone back to the end of the line for promotions. His career would have basically been over. So they actually did map about 200 miles of that northern Canadian coastline, which is only a fraction of that. But by this time, all his men were absolutely starving. They were eating bark, they were eating moss from trees, they were crunching any insects that they could. And eventually Franklin, with another winter coming, conceded that this was impossible. They had to quit and go back. On the way back, Franklin only survived by eating his own leather boots. And when they got back to England, he became famous as the man who ate his boots. Yeah, there was lots of stories told, newspaper articles, poems written about it. And in fact, when Charlie Chaplin was a boy growing up in London, he remembered hearing these stories. So in his a great masterpiece, The Gold Rush in 1925, which tells the story of the little tramp that goes to Alaska to make his fortune and so he can marry the woman he loves. He's starving and he has to boil up his boots and eat his own boots. And Chaplin said that he got the inspiration from Franklin for that story. But on the way back, 11 of the 20 men died, mostly of starvation, although one man was murdered by another member of the party who had gone crazy with hunger. Franklin himself and the other people were lucky that they were found by a local Native American Indian tribe. They were given food and they were taken back to safety. Now, the Canadian officials were scathing of Franklin. They said that this expedition was badly resourced, badly planned, and extremely badly led, and that Franklin had no common sense whatsoever, and that he was responsible for the deaths of those 11 men. But when Franklin got back to England, the British government was embroiled in a huge controversy. You have to try and go back to remember a time when they weren't involved in a huge controversy. But they couldn't afford any more bad news. So the story was spun of a great leader leading his men out of the wilderness against all odds. Franklin was promoted. He was given a knighthood and he became Sir John Franklin. And then in 1836, he was made Lieutenant Governor of Van Diemen's Land, which is present-day Tasmania. Now, at that time, Van Diemen's Land was a penal colony with convicts coming from Britain to be there. It was a very, very harsh place. Franklin made an immediate impact, and he's highly, very highly regarded even today for the social changes that he made and the difference he made to the lives of people in Van Diemen's Land at that time. He and his wife changed the whole aspect of what was being done there. They purchased land with their own money and built the very first non-denominational school in Tasmania. And for the first time anywhere in the world, any child, whether it be a child of a convict or a free man, could go to that school and get an education. Lady Franklin established a school for convict women to teach them how to sew and cook and clean, so they would be good wives for free men when they arrived to settle the area. They bought more land out of their own money, established a gardens there for fruit and vegetables, and that's the present-day Hobart Botanical Garden. So very, very well-regarded man, very popular, but not popular with everyone because the local bureaucrats didn't like him at all, and they white-anted him with his superiors back in London by saying that he was a petticoat governor. He was taking instructions from his wife, which was something he just didn't do at that time. So he was recalled from his job as governor 1 year before the term was due to expire, so he was effectively sacked from the job, which was extremely embarrassing for him. And then, as I said, in 1845, he was appointed as the officer commanding the British Northwest Passage Expedition, with Crozier as his second in command. Now, these men knew each other very well. They were good friends. On that voyage down to Antarctica with Ross, the ships Erebus and Terror had called into Hobart on the way down and on the way back, and they stayed there several months, and most nights they dined with the Franklins in Hobart. They became, as I said, very good friends. In fact, Crozier fell in love with Franklin's niece, the beautiful Sophia, and Crozier proposed marriage to her on two occasions. She refused, saying that she loved him, but she wouldn't marry a man like her uncle, who was an explorer, who would go to sea for months or even years, and she wouldn't know if he was going to return. So she later lived with Lady Franklin for the rest of her life. She wrote poetry, and a lot of that poetry refers to her long-lost love, who went to sea and never returned, and this is talking about Crozier. Now, they were going to take the same two ships that Ross had taken down to Antarctica, the Terror and the Erebus, but the ships were going to be very heavily modified. They were going to have 4-inch steel plating put all the way around the bottom of the hull to protect it from the crushing effects of the ice if they had to spend a winter in the ice before they got through to the Pacific. And then there was the biggest innovation of all. Both ships were going to have locomotive steam engines installed onto their ships, and that would drive a shaft with a propeller at the end of it, and that ship could now do 4 knots. Now, Four knots, we could walk at four knots. You know, it's walking pace. But back in those days, that was absolutely incredible because, I mean, we take it for granted now. We can turn the engines on here and we can just cruise out anytime we want to. But back in those days, if you wanted to leave a port or even enter a port, you had to wait until the wind and the tide were in your favour. You might have to wait days or even weeks before you had the right conditions to be able to leave a port. But now with this engine and this propeller, you were able to go against the wind and against the tide, and you could even push against some of those ice flows if you needed to, but you could also manoeuvre around those ice flows as well. Just absolutely incredible. Each of the ships also had steel or pipes running around the internals of the ship, and that steam engine used to pump water, hot water, through those pipes to heat up the inside of the ship like a radiator would do. So it was going to be very comfortable living on these ships, which was something that hadn't been done before. And each ship was going to have a library of 1,000 books, and they're also going to have costumes and art things that they could put on, pantomime plays for each other if they were going to have to spend a winter stuck in the ice at some stage. And the other huge innovation was that the French had just invented a method where they could preserve food and have it stored in tins. So they were going to take 3 years' supply of tin food with them. So this was incredible again, because it meant that they didn't have to either get off their ships and go and search for food on the ice, which was extremely scarce. So all these innovations made people very, very confident of success. They sailed from England on the 19th of May, 1845. Now this was, according to Crozier, he wrote in to his friends, he thought this was 6 weeks too late. He thought they'd missed their opportunity to get through in that first year. But because all these new innovations, the steam engines, for example, they had to be tested. There was problems. They had to be fixed and they had to be retested again and again and again. So that's why they left 6 weeks later than Crozier would have wanted to. There was going to be 24 officers and 110 men on board the two ships. And if you read the newspapers at the time, they were so confident. It wasn't a case of if they succeeded, it was when they succeeded in finding the Northwest Passage and when would they reach Hawaii. Would it be the first year? Would they just sail straight through? Or would they have to spend a winter in the ice? That was the big debate. Because with a man the caliber of Franklin, this expedition had no chance of failure whatsoever. They went over to Disko Bay on the west coast of Greenland. They took a supply ship with them. When they got to Disko Bay, all those supplies were put onto the two main ships, Erebus and Terra. And they went off. Five men were discharged as being unsuitable to go on the journey. We don't know why they were considered unworthy, but they were sent home. And then on the 29th of July, 1845, two American whaling vessels saw the two ships heading off into the ice of Baffin Bay. Now, those whalers later reported that the 129 men on board lined the rails of the ships and waved and cheered and were so happy, seemed so happy. Now, Erebus and Terra are wonderful names for warships, but perhaps not such great names for ships of discovery. Erebus in ancient Greek mythology is the names of the gates of hell. And as they were waving and cheering to those men aboard the whaling vessels, those 129 men had no inkling that they were sailing towards their own gates of hell and into the terror that lay beyond. Now, Lady Jane Franklin, Franklin's wife, was said to be a woman of great mental activity, which wasn't a compliment. She had opinions, which wasn't considered normal for that time. And gentlemen, don't say it out loud. It wasn't the good old days, all right. But she was a very rich woman in her right. She had inherited a lot of money from her father, and it was said that she set Franklin's compass. She told him which way to go. He probably would have been perfectly happy to stay at home and not volunteer for this expedition, but she wanted nothing more than her husband's name to be mentioned in the same breath as Cook and Frobisher and all these other, Parry and all these other great British explorers. So it was really her that was pushing him on at this time. Now, after her husband had been away for 18 months, she had a terrible premonition. She was concerned about what was going on. So she went to the Admiralty and told them about her concerns. And they were fairly condescending towards her. They said, you know, it's only been 18 months. We didn't really expect him to sail through all the way through the first year. He's probably had to winter in the ice for 1 year. He's got 3 years' supply of food. Just go home and sit by the fire and we'll let you know when something happens. But after 2.5 years, her husband had been away, she became very concerned. So she used her contacts, her political contacts, her media contacts, and her social contacts to put a lot of pressure on the Admiralty to do something. And finally, they had to act. And this is a portrait of the greatest British Arctic explorers of that generation who were meeting at the Admiralty to plan how they're going to go and search for Franklin and his men. And you can see in the background there's a portrait on the left-hand side there. That's Sir John Franklin's portrait in the background. Now, there's one great man that isn't shown in this this painting at all, and that is Sir James Clark Ross. He had already jumped on a ship and gone searching for his two great friends, Crozier and Franklin. He and his beautiful wife now had three children, either aged three or under, and the hardships of the Arctic didn't seem quite so bad anymore. But alas, he got no word. The Admiralty put out a reward of £20,000, which was an incredible amount of money at that time for any word of Franklin. So as well as the official voyages that went searching, there was also a lot of private voyages that went searching, American whaling vessels, British whaling vessels, etc. Now, the first word of what we know happened came 5 years after Franklin had sailed from London, where a ship called into a place called Beachy Island, and it seemed there was three graves there. Now, these were the graves of Petty Officer John Torrington, Royal Marine Billy Brain, and Petty Officer John Hartnell. Now, they died in January 46 and also in April 46. So this is only a few months after they've left London. And there was no other explanation. They just had the dates of their death. So why had three healthy men died so early on into this expedition? There was nothing. There was no evidence at all about what had gone on. It raised more questions than it answered. Now, it seemed that they'd been at Disco Bay. They'd travelled across to Beachy Island, where number two is there. And then they'd gone north when they came out of the ice there, and then came down south towards King William Island. And what they didn't know was that as they were coming south, that ice was early this year, and it followed them down, it shadowed them down until they became entombed on King William Island and they weren't going anywhere for that winter. Now, the next thing we know is that when a man by the name of Dr. John Ray became involved. Now, he was a Scot. He had been born in the Orkney Islands, and he went to Canada and worked for the Hudson Bay Company as their doctor. And he treated all the Hudson Bay employees, but he also went out and treated the Inuits in that region. He became very friendly with the Inuits, and they took him on expeditions. And eventually, he became the best renowned overland explorer for that sort of region. He came back from a journey and he received two letters, one from the Admiralty and a personal letter from Lady Jane Franklin imploring him to go and search for word of her husband. So he set off and he went north with some Inuit guides and he met a Inuit family and they had in their possession some articles, tools, cutlery, crockery, badges, jewellery, which were obviously from the men of the Franklin expedition. Some of them had initials on them. Now, when Ray questioned them, they said that there were many white bodies on King William Island. They gave him information about things that they had heard how the men were found on King William Island, and they gave them second and third hand accounts of Inuit interaction with these men. And one of the stories was that two Inuit hunters came across a party of 30 white men. These men indicated that they were very hungry, so the Inuit gave them some whale meat, which the men scoffed down without even cooking at all. These men started pointing to the Inuit's dogs on their dog sleds and arguing amongst themselves. So the Inuits panicked and they left, which might seem harsh, leaving these men. But you have to remember that these Inuit were living on the margins of survival themselves. There was no, they didn't hardly had enough food for their own families, let alone feeding another 30 hungry men. And if their dogs had been killed and eaten by these men, it probably would have been a death sentence for them and their families, which is why they left. But Ray had a choice. He could either go to King William Island himself and investigate what had happened, but if he did, it would be another winter before he got back, and so that would be 18 months before any word got back to England. So he decided that he would just go back to England with some of the artifacts and explain what had happened. And when he got back, he did a report, and part of that report said that from the mutilated state of many of the corpses and the contents of the kettles, it is evident that our wretched countrymen had been driven to the last resource, cannibalism, as a means to prolong existence. Now, when this was released in Britain, it caused an absolute sensation. Lady Franklin was absolutely furious. There was no way that Englishmen would resort to cannibalism. There was no way that Englishmen under her husband's command would ever resort to cannibalism. She was furious. She threatened to sue Ray. She made sure that he didn't receive any of that reward money for several years afterwards. She enlisted some of her contacts to absolutely murder Ray's reputation, including the great author Charles Dickens, who wrote in a newspaper article that Ray was either, at best, he was confused and naive, at worst, he was complicit with these Inuit who were savages themselves. If anyone, they were obviously thieves, they'd robbed the bodies of these men. They probably murdered Franklin and his men themselves, and if anyone had cannibalized them, it was probably the Inuit. And Charles Dickens, the author of A Christmas Carol, wrote that he thought that the Inuit should be exterminated from the earth. Just crazy stuff. But it absolutely destroyed Ray's reputation for many, many years afterwards. And no one really took the Inuit story very seriously at all, until some time later, another Scot by the name of Francis McClintock decided he would check out King William Island for himself. His men came across a can of stones. They dug into that can and they found a metal box. And inside that metal box, there was a note. And the note read, 28th of May, 1847, Her Majesty's ship Erebus and Terror wintered in the ice in longitude. Having wintered in 1846-47 at Beachy Island in longitude, after having ascended Wellington Channel to latitude 77 and returned by the west side of Cornwallis Island, signed Sir John Franklin, commanding the expedition, and then scrawled underneath was all well. All well. Now, this was strange. If you were going to go to the trouble of building a can of stones and burying a note in there, why would you just rip out a page from a book and scribble a little note like that? Why wouldn't you use normal writing paper to write out more information about that? That doesn't really tell us anything. And there's also a glaring mistake here. They didn't winter at Beachy Island in 46-47, it was 45-46. We know that from the dates on the graves. How could he have made such a basic error? Just crazy. But even worse, that note had been buried, but someone had come along later on, they'd taken the note out, and there was another note scribbled around the outside of that letter. And that said, 25th of April, 1848, Her Majesty's ship Terror and Erebus were deserted on the 22nd of April, 5 leagues north-northwest of this, having been beset since the 12th of September, 1846. They'd been stuck in the ice for more than 2 years. The officers and crew, consisting of 105 souls, under the command of Captain Crozier, landed here in latitude, longitude, and then the big news. Sir John Franklin died on the 11th of June, 1847, so only 2 weeks after he wrote All Well. And the total of loss by deaths in the expedition has been to this date 9 officers and 15 men. Same sign, James Fitzjames, the captain of Erebus, and Crozier, captain and senior officer. And it says down the, also says, start tomorrow to Back's Fish River, which was 1,000 miles away. Just impossible to get to. Now, once again, why? If you're going to get into this, dig into this can of stones and write another note, why wouldn't you use a normal piece of writing paper and give a lot more information than that? How did Sir John Franklin die? Where was he buried? How come there's such a large ratio of officers that have died compared to enlisted men? There was only 100. There's only 24 officers, and 9 have died. So how come such a large ratio? Now, the other thing was, why have they deserted the vessels in April, late April? This is spring coming into summer. There was a possibility that those ships would have been able to break free of the ice in summer. Were the ships damaged? We don't know any information at all. Now, McClintock's men also found one of the ship's boats. When they found it, it was pointing back to where, in the direction of where the ships had been. So we don't know whether the men were trying to get back to those ships. Inside this boat, they found 2 skeletons, one of them holding a loaded musket. But some of the items that they found in the boat were very, very confusing. There was dress uniforms. There were books. There were things like brushes and combs and mirrors. There was 50 pounds of chocolate, which was proof that there was no women on this expedition, because that would have been the first thing to go. But, I mean, if you were starving, wouldn't you eat all this chocolate? I mean, it didn't make any sense. There were even brass curtain rails and costumes for the pantomime plays. I mean, if you were going to have to drag these boats across King William Island, and you needed the boats because it was an island, they needed to get to the mainland, wouldn't you only take the bare essentials that you would need to survive? Why would you drag all this other stuff along with you? It didn't make any sense whatsoever. Now, they were stuck in the ice. They had to drag these boats along. And we know now that they came all the way down that west coast of King William Island. We know this because all of the bodies and other things that have been found along the way. Some of the bodies were found as individuals, some were in groups, and there was plenty of evidence by the state of the bodies that there was cannibalism involved. A lot of the limbs had been filleted, there was nicks in the bones, there were scrapes on the bones with knives, there was bones in cooking pots, etc. So they had resorted to cannibalism, but by this time, when Lady Franklin found out about this, she wasn't so concerned because her husband had died prior to this happening. They also found tea canisters and hat badges and pocket watches and things, but they also found porcelain dinner sets and things. Why would you take that with you if you were trying to flee for your life? Just didn't make any sense. Now, in 1981, scientists in Canada applied to the government to exhume the 3 bodies on Beachy Island to see whether there was anything that they could tell us about what had happened. Now, in a second, I'm going to put up a photo with photos of the bodies. Now, a lot of people don't like that sort of thing, so if you don't like it, could you please turn away now, and I'll only have it up for a few seconds, and I'll put something else up there. So if you don't want to see these bodies, turn away now. You bloodthirsty lot, no one turned away. So this is Torrington, Blaine and Hartnell. And as you can see, the bodies are in very good condition, preserved by the permafrost at that time. I'll put something nicer up. When the autopsies were done, they found very high levels of lead in their systems. Now, London was a very polluted city at that time, but even that wouldn't account for the lead that they found in these bodies. What had caused all this lead? Nearby, they found the tins of the meat, a big supply of empty tins. Now, when the this is new technology. When the company won the tender ironically, it was on April Fool's Day. They had never, no one had ever received an order this big before. It was for to feed three meals a day for 130 men for 3 years. So it was a huge order. They didn't have enough staff to fill the order. They had to hire in all this unskilled labor. And when they soldered the tin together, they used lead solder. And because these people were unskilled, it was like they painted the lead on with a paintbrush. And when you put those tins into boiling water to heat up the contents, that lead just melted like candle wax into the food. And this is assumed to have something to do with it. Now, also the steam engine, those pipes inside the ship, they were all made of lead as well. The officers had access to those pipes with a tap in their quarters for shaving and for making their tea. And that might give an indication of why there was more officers died during this than enlisted men. Now, the amounts of lead that they found wouldn't be enough to kill someone outright, but it would severely impact your judgment, your reasoning ability, your thinking, and your decision making. So that's probably something to do with what has happened here. Now, I said there was a lot of expeditions that went in search of Franklin and his men. Perhaps the most famous one was the Resolute, which was the pride of the British Navy. If anyone could find Franklin and his men, it was the Resolute. They set sail from England with a flotilla of five vessels under the command of a Commodore. When they got to Baffin Bay, the Commodore sent the Resolute forward into the ice, and he's divided the other ships up to search in other areas, and he based himself in Baffin Island. Now, after a few weeks, the Resolute became stuck in the ice, which was expected. That was going to happen, always going to happen. The captain wasn't concerned. He sent out sledging parties from his ships searching for news of Franklin and his men. Now, one of those sledging parties, under the command of a man by the name of George Nares, who happens to be a personal hero of mine, and I'll be doing a talk about him later in the cruise, after 16 days, he came across HMS Investigator. They were stuck in the ice. Investigator had left England 4 years before. They'd sailed all the way down the bottom around Cape Horn, resupplied in Hawaii, and went up above Alaska and came in from the Pacific side. But it became stuck in the ice, and it was stuck in the ice for 3 years. The last 12 months, the men had been on half rations, so they were sick and very weak at that time. Very grateful to see the men from the Resolute. So Nares sent word back to his captain about what he'd found. He stayed with the crew of the Investigator for 2 or 3 weeks until they were able to go back onto full rations and build their strength up. And then they all went back to the Resolute. Now, in the meantime, the captain of the Resolute had sent word back to his commander, his Commodore, back at Baffin Bay. And that Commodore, who one day wanted to become an admiral, could see disaster all written all over this. He basically overreacted. He panicked a little bit, and he ordered the captain of the Resolute to abandon the ship and bring everyone back to Baffin Bay to safety. The captain of the Resolute protested the order, but it was an order and he had to obey. So the Resolute was abandoned and the men made this very hard trek back to Baffin Bay. Now, 18 months later and 1,500 miles from where it was abandoned, it was discovered by an American whaling vessel. It was in very good shape. They went aboard, they claimed the salvage rights, and they sailed the ship back to Philadelphia. Now, the American Congress had a dilemma. The US and Great Britain had been at war with each other twice in the last 80 years. Now, but Great Britain was the natural defensive partner, the natural trading partner. So Congress allocated $40,000, which was a fortune at that time, to purchase the salvage rights and bring the Resolute back into pristine condition. And then they sailed it across the Atlantic and they presented it as a gift to the people of Great Britain. Queen Victoria herself came down to the wharf to accept this gift. And it said that the moment she stepped foot onto the deck of the Resolute is when what's known as the special relationship between the United States and Great Britain began. Now, 25 years later, when the Resolute was decommissioned, it was being broken up, Queen Victoria ordered that the very best timbers be used to create a desk. Recognise it? The Resolute desk was presented to President Rutherford B. Hayes in 1880. It's been used by every American president ever since. And wouldn't you love it if this desk could speak, tell stories? The good news is that the British actually bugged it. No, I'm just joking. But it's been used by every president ever since. A bit of history for you. Now, very quickly, because we've run out of time, the Erebus and the Terror were found, the Erebus in 2014, the Terror in 2016, exactly where the Inuit said that they would be found. They drifted around. Now, there's statues to Franklin in his native Lincolnshire, also in London, and in Hobart in Tasmania as well. Mainly put up by thanks to Lady Franklin. On the inscription on these statues, I don't know whether you can read it from back there, but it says, "To the great Arctic navigator and his brave companions who sacrificed their lives in completing the discovery of the Northwest Passage." A little bit of poetic license from Lady Franklin. They didn't complete the discovery at all. That honour went to the great Norwegian Raoul Amundsen, who was able to become the first person to sail through the Northwest Passage from the Atlantic to the Pacific between 1903 and 1906, before he went on to become the first person to reach the South Pole. But the whole idea of finding the Northwest Passage became absolutely redundant only 25 years after Franklin sailed from London with the opening of the Suez Canal. We now had a safe way to get through into the Indian Ocean. So ladies and gentlemen, that's the story of the Lost Franklin Expedition. I hope you've enjoyed it, and I'll see you around the ship. Thank you very much.